How many of you enjoyed the worship? Hope we have an opportunity that we get to teach and preach on worship. But that's the mission of the church, is to glorify God and to be on His mission. And maybe, just maybe, it's been a tough week. Maybe it's been a tough weekend. I don't know what's happened. But in this moment, could you just be sensitive to God and ask Him to work. Ask Him to touch you. Because there's such a sense right now in our country, and I'm going to talk a bit about it in the scriptures this morning, but there's such a sense of just hatred, and there's just such a sense of heaviness. And I don't know, can you feel it? Can you feel it from Monday to Saturday? Can you feel it? To the point that you don't want to turn the news on. To the point that you don't want to look at social media. It's all around us. And that negativity is creeping into our homes and creeping into our spiritual lives, to the point that asking this question, God, are you there? To the point that I start to think that maybe we could be worse than Sodom and Gomorrah. Could we? When we think of the issues that we have to deal with and the things that we listen to, could we be worse than Sodom and Gomorrah? We heard a few weeks ago that when it came to Noah's time, that the sin was left to the imagination of people. That is a scary place to be. That anything goes. Anything goes. But this morning I pray that this word will be a word of encouragement and also a challenging word to each and every one of us. Now, for those of us that are visiting us for the very first time, we've been going through a series called Forward in Faith and looking at the heroes of the faith in the book of Hebrews chapter 11. And if you have your Bibles, you can open up to Hebrews chapter 11 verse 23 to 28. But before we get there, ever heard or made the statement, there's no place like home? No place like home. There is no place like home. Each time I go to East London, yes, there's no place like home. There's a sense of belonging. There's a sense of community. There's love. There's a smell in your old home. Okay, there's something about it. Now, for grandparents and parents that are sitting here, you would understand of what it's like when your kids come home. You get to make sure that the house is clean. The pots are probably on the stove. Because why? Your kids are coming home. And they know, they long, as much as they're living and they've got their own places, they long to come home. Home is where the heart is. We can go on holiday for a week or 2 weeks, but when we get home, there's a longing to be at home. And in a sense, we feel that, you know, that when we're in a different place, we are foreign in a different place. We don't want to do anything out of the ordinary just in case we get arrested. We don't know what it's like in certain places. And for some of us, maybe we've experienced that we're very cautious when we go to other places. And in most cases, we look forward of going back home. Where, like I said, there's a sense of community, there's love, there's compassion. I know what's happening in that community. I know what's happening in our home. Now, for us as believers, we can relate to this because Paul says to the Philippians, and he says this in Philippians chapter 3, verse 20 to 21, "But we are citizens of heaven, where the Lord Jesus Christ lives, and we are eagerly waiting for Him to return as our Savior." What Paul is actually saying is that we don't belong here. We belong somewhere else. This is not our home, but what we've done is we've made this our earthly home. And when we look at all the stuff that's happening around us, the crime, the rape, the racism, everything that's happening around us, as believers, we can identify to say that we don't belong here. This is not a part of who we are. Look at the depravity of the world. This is not us. We don't agree with what's happening in the world. We don't agree with the sin. We don't agree. And yes, you're right. Because Paul says we don't belong here. Where do we belong? We are citizens of heaven. And we wait. And we wait. We're busy waiting for the return of Jesus Christ. But in this waiting period, unfortunately, we need to live this life out. Unfortunately, in this waiting period, we need to go through this life. And we see in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23 to 28, we pick up on the story of Moses. Now we know Moses, and probably most of us know the song, How Did Moses Cross the Red Sea? Did he walk? Remember that song? How did Moses cross the Red Sea? And it sticks in your head. How did Moses cross the Red Sea? Jesus opened it up, am I right? Well, God opened it up for the Israelites to walk through. But we see the story of Moses in the book of Exodus. That Moses was born a crime. Now, for those of you who know Trevor Noah, he wrote a book, Born a Crime. Remember that? So I'm going to just take that statement, Born a Crime. Moses was born a crime. After Joseph was on the scene, a new Pharaoh came into power, or a new king came into power, and he knew nothing of who Joseph was. Absolutely nothing about the agreement that there was made that the Israelite nation were free to live in a land in Egypt. So the new king came along and said, well, you know what? The Hebrew people are growing in number and in stature, and they're becoming stronger than us. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to oppress them in Exodus chapter 1. We're going to oppress them. Basically, we're going to make them our slaves because we need to put them under control. Because if they get out of hand, guess what's going to happen? They are going to overpower us. And that's what happened. And then it got to the point where Pharaoh came up with a brilliant idea to say to the midwives of the Israel nation, I want you to kill every male boy. As soon as the woman gives birth, if it's a girl, it's fine, but every male boy, I want you to kill them. But these ladies didn't do that. What did they do? They were obedient to God. And they feared the Lord, and they did not do that. And eventually, Pharaoh asked them, well, what's the story with this? Why are you not doing it? And God's grace was upon them, and the midwife said, well, you know, these ladies are not like the Egyptian ladies. The babies, they're just popping out the babies before we can even get there. I don't know how Pharaoh took that, but the next step that Pharaoh took, he told these people that I want you to go around and I want you to find every male child and I want you to throw them in the Nile River. Isn't that barbaric? But he was determined to destroy the Israel nation. However, there was a guy and there was a lady, Moses' parents, and the scripture says in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 23 that by the faith of Moses, let's read that. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw that the child was beautiful and they were not afraid of the king's edict. Now, Moses' parents had faith. They had faith in God and they knew that this was wrong. So they hid Moses for 3 months. Moses was born a crime. But the scripture says that they hid him because they saw that he was beautiful. Now, when you look at the original text, actually, there was a gift on Moses' life. There was a calling on the life of Moses. In the book of Acts, chapter 7, verse 20, when Stephen is giving a speech, he actually says there, and he quotes this, and he says that God saw that Moses was beautiful. That God saw it. But there was a calling on the life of Moses. But Moses lived a messed up life, unfortunately, because he was born a crime, and when the parents couldn't hide him anymore, the mom put him in a basket and put him down the Nile River. Pharaoh's daughter sees him, picks him up, and adopts him, and gives him back to the mom to nurse until he grows up. At this point, we see that there's no place like home for Moses because Moses doesn't know where he belongs. Imagine being in that position. Imagine being in that position of not knowing where you belong. Do I belong in Pharaoh's court or do I belong with the Israel people or the Hebrews? When he grows up, he goes back and Pharaoh's daughter adopts him and he starts living there. And he gets all the privileges, but he still doesn't belong because he knows that he's a Hebrew. And it gets to the point where he's grown up and he's mature and he sees what the Egyptians are doing to his people. And the scripture goes on and he says that Moses defends a Hebrew person and he kills an Egyptian, buries him in the sand. And the next day, He sees two Hebrew guys fighting and he breaks up the fight. And that's where the news gets out. It probably wasn't Facebook or CNN or Instagram or Twitter that the day before that Moses killed this Egyptian and hit him in the sand. Maybe it was in the Sunday Times. I don't know. But the Hebrews say, well, are you going to deal with us the same way that you dealt with that Egyptian? And out of fear, Moses flees because Pharaoh heard about this and was going to kill him. And he flees and he goes away and he still hasn't found a place called home because he leaves. And he goes to a place and then he works for his father-in-law and it's still not his home. And we know that God appears to him in a burning bush and gives him the message to go back to Egypt to save the people. But Moses is still a foreigner. Moses is still a foreigner. But let's continue to read verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. Scripture goes on, verse 27, by faith he left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Verse 28, by faith he kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not touch them. In the same way that we are foreigners here on this earth and we belong, we are citizens of heaven, the same way that Moses had no place or could to call his home. But for us, I want us to take a few lessons away from here. And I pray that this will be an encouragement to each and every one of us. That even in this time of toughness, even in this time that we feel that we're enslaved in this world that we need to live in, I pray that we will take away at least a few things from Moses' life and the faith that he had in God our Father. And the first thing we see, that as we live this life, and as we are foreigners on earth, the first thing that we need to identify with is that God has a plan for our lives. Can we repeat that? God has a plan for our lives. We don't know what that plan is, but I need to believe and have faith that God has a plan for our lives. Verse 23, it says, by faith Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months. His parents had faith in God and hid him, but there was a plan and there was a purpose and there was a calling on the life of Moses. Now, whether we want to believe it or not, that we are created in the image and the likeness of God. As human beings, this is one thing that we fail to identify with, that is that our identity is in Jesus Christ. Teenagers deal with this and they struggle with this because they can't find themselves. They don't know who they are. What is my identity? I spoke about this, it was either a couple months ago or last year, that when you know who you are, you'll know what to do. And for some of us as adults, we are still struggling with that. We're still struggling with our identity. And this morning, that if you're a believer, you need to know that you're a child of the living God. And there's a few scriptures that identify this for us. In the book of Jeremiah, God speaks to Jeremiah and says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you and I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. I don't know what that means for you, but I'm privileged and I'm honored to know that God knew me before the foundations of the earth. That I belong somewhere and to someone. No matter how messed up my life might be, no matter if I don't belong anywhere, but I know that I belong to God because He's designed me and He's created me. The second thing, in Psalms 139, the psalmist says, for you formed my inward parts, you knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. God has a plan and a purpose for each and every one of us. It is for us as his children to seek and to seek his will. Paul says in the book of Romans that we need to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, and this is our reasonable act of worship, and we will know the will of God when we seek Him. When we seek Him, God has a plan and a purpose. The first thing that we need to know is that as we live this life here on earth, I know that we're waiting for Jesus to come back. But as we live this life, we need to know who we are and we need to be confident in that. When we are faced with a decision and a choice to make, do we know that it's the right choice to make based on God's word? Do we know who we are? If we call ourselves a Christian and a believer, do we know who we are? Church, do we know who we are? Number two is that by faith, we need to know that God wants us to prosper, meaning there is a purpose. There is a purpose. Now, there's a difference between a plan and a purpose. A plan is putting a blueprint together and having an idea of where we're going to go and what we're going to do. The purpose is that I can see the end result and I can see the goal, and that's what I'm aiming for, like you can see that arrow there. There is a purpose. Moses, by faith, when he was grown up, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Now, what that actually means is that he understood that he was a Hebrew and that there was a bigger God out there, and he understood that. And he knew that his purpose wasn't to indulge in the pleasures of sin and wasn't to indulge in the pleasures of Pharaoh. Now, Moses had an opportunity to be privileged. He had an opportunity to be privileged. He had the best education. The scripture unpacks that. He was a warrior because he basically killed the Egyptian. He was well trained. I'm assuming he was well built. I'm assuming he had leadership qualities there because he was trained in Pharaoh's court. But Moses had to make a decision. And this is what the Hebrew writer says. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt. Greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt. You see, church, that as we live this life, the first thing is we need to know who we are. The second thing is we need to know what our purpose is. Now, Dr. James Dobson, most of you would have heard about him and read his books. He writes a story of an incident that happened in his home. And he says, when my daughter was a teenager, she came home one day and said, "Hey, Dad, I got some great news. There's a great game out there, and this game is called Monopoly." So James just shrugs his shoulders and says, "Oh, that's nice." So they gathered together as a family to play this board game. And without his kids knowing, they start playing this board game, and James starts to beat the children. Now, of course, the kids were annoyed because they thought that he did not know how to play the game. And after, when the game was about to close, the children made him pack the game up because they were frustrated with him. And he goes on and he says that as he began putting all of the money back in the box, a very empty feeling came over me. He says, "Everything that I had accumulated was gone. The excitement over riches was just an illusion." And then it occurred to me, hey, this isn't just the game of Monopoly that has caught my attention. This is the game of life. And isn't that so true? You sweat and you strain to get ahead, but then one day, after a little chest pain or a wrong change of lanes on the freeway, the game ends. It all goes back in the box. You leave this world just as naked as the day you came into it. I once saw a bumper sticker that proclaimed, "He who dies with the most toys wins." That's wrong. It should say, "He who dies with the most toys dies anyway." Purpose. Every day we go through this, the sweat and the strain in life. Moses could have chose privilege, but he chose Christ's wealth instead. For us, as much as knowing our identity, what is our purpose in life? What are we striving for? What do we get up every morning to do every single day? Is it for the riches of this world? Is it to prosper? Yes, God does want us to be prosperous, but in the things of Him. But in the things of Him. You see, Jesus says in such a lovely way that we don't serve two masters, and we can't serve two masters. So this morning, I want you to think about, what is your purpose for getting up in the morning? What is your purpose in life? Are we choosing to make our work? Are we choosing to make money? Are we choosing to make our career? Are we choosing to make this life everything when it's not supposed to be? But there's such an encouragement from Jesus. And I want to read the text. If your Bibles are still open, Turn with me to the book of Matthew, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation, Matthew chapter 6, and this is what Jesus says, and the encouragement to us. He says this, "Don't store up treasures here on earth, where moths eat them and dust destroys them, and where thieves break in and steal. Store your treasures in where? In heaven." Jesus, seriously? Store my treasures in heaven. Is there a special elevator, or is there somewhere that I can EFT it? Or what does it look like for us? Store up your treasures in heaven, where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in or steal. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will also be. This is such a challenging statement. What are the treasures of our heart? What are the treasures of our heart? Think about that for a second. Because where your treasures are, that is where your heart will be also. That is the thing that you'll invest and put your time and effort in. Because, I don't want to go here, but I'm going to go here. Is that okay? That if we're concerned about our spiritual walk with the Lord, we will make an effort to be at a Bible study. Oh, that's harsh. Seriously, if we're concerned, if we want to be built up spiritually and know what God has planned for us, we will make time to be here on a Sunday morning. If we're concerned about our walk with the Lord, we will make time to open up our Bible and have a devotion. Am I touching base with somebody? If we're concerned about people's lives and their salvation, we will make an effort to be in their company to tell them the good news about Jesus Christ instead of playing church. Does it make sense? Now, I know I have no hair in my head. Can you see that? I know I have no hair. But I still go and cut my hair. Now, it could be a fruitless exercise. But you know what I discovered? That the people that I go to are Muslim people. And with me consistently going there with intention, as I sit in that chair with them having a blade to my neck, I talk about the gospel with them. Because now we have such a good relationship that when I walk in there, they know who I am, and they know that I'm a pastor, and this is the conversation that we're going to have in that chair. And I'm trusting God that they're going to come to know the Lord. Can you understand about intention? What is our purpose? Because where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be also. Jesus goes on and says, "No one can serve two masters, for you can hate the one and love the other. You will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and be enslaved to money." It's amazing of how that comes up. Because that's driving us. If I had more money, guess what? That I'll pay the church's bond off. If I had more money, I will give money to missions. If I had. But what do you have to give? Jesus goes on and says, "That is why I tell you, do not worry about everyday life, whether you have enough food and drink or either clothes to wear. Isn't life more than food?" And the answer is, we're not sure. If we're not sure, isn't life more than food and your body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They don't plant or harvest or store food in barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them, and aren't you far more valuable to Him than they are? And the answer is, we're still not sure. Can all your worries add a single moment to your life? And the answer is, we're still not sure. Church, that's concerning that you're not answering that questions. Who are we? We are children of the Most High God. He says, do not worry about a single day of our life. What is our purpose? What are we striving for? The fact that we can't answer confidently that, yes, I can't add a single day if I worry. Yes, my life is more important than food and clothing. Because why? Because I serve a God that will provide for me. This is who we are, church. We are the hope of the world. We've got this message. But if we go out there as wimps, that they are not confident in who we are, this world is relying on us. Verse 28. "And why worry about your clothing? Look at the lilies of the field and how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing. Yet Solomon, in all his glory, was not dressed as beautifully as they are." And verse 30 says, "And if God cares so wonderfully for wildflowers, that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. Why do you have so little faith? The series is Forward in Faith. Our purpose, what are we striving for? Maybe we need to relook at that. What are we striving for? Moses had an opportunity to have privilege, but he chose the wealth of Christ. And that's eternal life, because the scripture says that he kept his eye on the reward. We are not citizens of here, we are citizens of heaven, waiting for Jesus Christ to come back. That our eyes are fixed on the reward that we're going to receive one day in heaven. Because that is greater and much better than what we receive here on earth. And yes, we enjoy and we love the tap on the back and the compliments that we get. But that is fruitless and that is not worth it compared to what Jesus Christ is going to give us one day. Am I right? Where moths cannot destroy it and thieves cannot take it. And as we live here on earth, the one thing that we're scared of is death. And Jesus takes care of that as well. So we need to know our identity. The second thing is that we need to know, why do we get up every morning? There's a purpose and there's a plan. God does want us to prosper. The third thing is that he has taken care of death, because Moses, by faith, in verse 28, he kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not touch them. By faith, you see, when in the book of Exodus, there were all these plagues that came for the people of Israel to be released. And after each plague, Pharaoh said, yes, I will release. And then he changed his mind. Now, after all those plagues, after 9 or 10 of them, what do you think happens to your faith? What happens? You're despondent. There's no way that this God is going to save us. Look what Pharaoh is doing. But eventually, the crunch time has come where the Passover comes and the angel of death was going to come, and Jesus and God was going to come and rescue his people. And by faith and in trust, they put the blood over the doorpost. In fact, they took it to a step further where the instruction was, I want you to have the staff in your hand, and I want you to have your cloak on and your sandals on in preparation and readiness, because I'm going to save you. And the Israelites had to do that because it was their faith, believing that God was going to rescue them. And we see that this Passover is acknowledged, and we see up to this very day that it's acknowledged of what God did for them and took them out of slavery. And I challenge you and I encourage you to be here on Thursday, Maundy Thursday, where we're going to experience the Passover. And it's going to be unpacked of what the Israelites actually went through and what Jesus was talking about. But today we acknowledge that at the communion table. You know, when we come before the Lord and we have the grape juice and we have the bread? What is it in? It's in remembrance of what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. That death has been conquered, and we don't have to worry about that in this life, because we don't belong here. We belong with Jesus Christ. He's taken care of the thing that we fear the most. We're scared of leaving our family behind. We're scared of how are they going to be taken care of. We're scared. Maybe we're not sure when we close our eyes here on earth of what's going to happen. But Jesus Christ came. And he died for each and every one of us. And his blood was shed that our sins could be cleansed, no matter who we are, that it was washed away and that we'd be made whiter than snow and made right with God, justified. And on the third day, the most amazing thing happened, that he conquered death, proving that he gives us life and life to the full here on earth. So our confidence needs to be in a God that is living and is alive forevermore. This morning, church, I want to challenge you and ask you this question as I close. Does God have full control of our lives? In spite of our circumstances and in spite of all that's happening around us, do we allow him to take full control of our lives? Now, for those of you who have pens, do you have some of you that have pens in your hand? Can I ask a favor? Can I ask a huge favor? Can you lift your pen up for me? Thank you, for those of our pens. Now, the only way that pen can work is that if it's placed in your hand. Am I right? The only way that God can use us and God can use each and every one of us in terms of what we need to do here on earth is we need to place our lives in his hands. We know who we are in Jesus. We know what our purpose is. We know that he died for us. So what is stopping us from taking this gospel and going on his mission and doing it? Are we allowing ourselves to be placed in the hands of God so that he could use us as Moses did? Moses didn't see, he saw the promised land, he didn't get to experience it, but he was faithful to what God had for him. With our heads bowed and eyes closed here this morning. Can you think about this for a second and place your life in the hands of God? Confidently saying, Lord, take control. Take control. So this morning we're going to sing the song again in closing. Death was arrested. And my life began. So just in an attitude of worship, I want you to listen to the words. If you know the words, sing. But I pray that it'll speak life into our hearts. So this morning, may the Lord bless and keep you, and may he make his face shine upon you, and be gracious to you, and grant you his peace. In Jesus' name.
Alone my sorrow and dead my sin. Lost without hope, with no place to begin.